My meaning of being a successful mother has evolved as I've been a mother longer. My children have gotten older. My children are 25, 24, 22. And so when I was younger, being a successful mom, I thought I was getting it right every single time. So when I didn't get it right, I was beating myself over the head and just really hard to let go of the fact that I just wasn't perfect. And as time passed, and I realized what amazing, resilient people our children are, being a successful mother was really being a mother who was present in spirit, available to my children, to teach them even the hard lessons, being able to be a disciplinarian, even though you kind of not want the kids to look at you like, but being able to just step up and be what the children need. Not being afraid to fail as a parent, understanding that as a mom, I don't know, I'm not gonna be long-winded, but as it evolves. And even for whatever your definition is in your mind or in your heart today of what being a mother is, just know that 10 years from now, it won't be that. 5 years from now, it won't be that. Next week, it might not be that, because life changes us and things happen and we evolve. And as we learn, we understand.
Be a successful mother, I understood that I had to cultivate the gift that God gave my child versus me wanting to have her or him be what I wasn't in my past. So a lot of times for me, that was tweetable. I'm sorry. A lot of times what we do is because we want to live through our children, because we weren't able to do that when we were younger, we tried to put things on them that we wanted to do. And instead of looking at the gift and the talents that God has given them and saying, okay, Lord, teach me how to cultivate and nurture that, so then they can be great men and great women, and successful mothers and fathers. So that's what I would say.
I am your token. God didn't bless me with it. Birthing of a child, Mom. I got my fur baby up there. But what I'm able to see, the truth is, I am a mother. I'm just not a mother to my own birth children. I'm a mother to my nieces. I'm a mother to my business. I'm a mother to anyone who needs my loving, supporting ear and shoulder.
And then also leading by example. Showing my kids that we're all here to be of service and to help others in whatever they do in life, because I am, you know, a proponent of letting your kids choose their own journey. But just know that whatever they do, they need to be of service and they should be helping others. So that's how I define being successful.
I would define being a successful mother, just, you know, keeping my kids spiritually grounded, you know, and I always encourage my kids. My kids are my best friends, so I have fun. I know we have to be, Flex is a disciplinarian, but I like to have fun with my kids, so because I want my kids to feel like instead of turning to their friends at school, they can always talk to me about anything. Some stuff may be a little uncomfortable, but I like for them to always be able to share things with me, and I like to, like you said, live by example. I like to be a great example.
Lucrece has an amazing story that I just kind of want to talk a little bit about with her daughter that I've known since she was a little girl. But Lucrece was telling me about Naja going to college, and Naja, you know, got accepted in college and then decided that she wanted to try out to be in the arts, right, in the music department. Well, in the music department, you have to try out. Lucrece felt like Naja would play sports and do all these things to get a scholarship. End up being Naja performed. I want y'all to look at the video, but Naja performed for this college, and not only did she get accepted in the arts program and the music program, she got a full ride because she sang and, yeah. But it was so funny when I was talking to Lucrece and she was saying, well, I just wanted her, I was pushing her to scholarship for that. Sometimes, and it's what she did, you have to listen to the gift of the child. And so I commend kids like that. I mean, but LaCrease Coleman, y'all look at that video of Naja singing, it will bless you.
Each of us has our own destiny path that we're supposed to walk. So first and foremost, you can't compare what that looks like inside of your home and for your family to what the neighbors or your sisters or your moms was. I don't believe you can do that until you're very, very clear on what it is you're supposed to do. And then when you are clear on what it is you're supposed to do, you create that environment for growth and for excellence in your home. That'll be the lessons that your children learn from you and watching you do that. And I'll teach them how to do that as they walk out their own lives. So, and I said that for a reason, because to someone who works in corporate America, what they needed to do to support their family and not neglect their family at the same time is not going to look the same way that it looked for me. Because in order for me to be successful at what I did, it required me to be gone for extended periods of time. At times, and just know that as a working mother in this field, it feels no different. Like you go, Shamis, you can attest to that. You go through feeling like, oh my God, I need to be with my children and I can't be there. But I also believe that because, and this is the church girl in me, I also believe that our children are assigned to us. So this is what you have to tell yourself. Don't be afraid to walk in what you were called to walk in. God gave you those kids. They're assigned to you, so they're already equipped to deal with the life that He's planned for you with them. Find that space, and in doing excellent, you teach your kids how to be excellent. But you always make time for them. You follow me? And we said this in another city, that balance is not 50-50. Balance is having parts that measure up to 100%. And so this week, you may be able to be 70% of all of that, and the other 30 comes from if it's your spouse or whoever your support system and family is, and what makes up the 100% of the environment of your household and the support for your children. But you can't overshadow yourself with that. We teach by example. So in doing that, that's how you not neglect your kids, because to not be excellent and to not show them what it is to go for something and get it, you're still not. That's a neglect of a sort as well. And so you want to be able to do what you've been called to do, because it teaches your children that it is their responsibility to walk out the call on their lives as well. So do that knowing that you're not neglecting them, but always find time inside of you. You teach those lessons, but then you teach them the other traditional lessons.
But I think it's all about prioritization. You know, knowing when you have to put your family first and your career first. And not feeling guilty about it. Because, you know, a lot of times as moms and as wives, we feel guilty. And I think we have to let that go and know it's just all about prioritization to make things happen.
Loving to the people around us, to our partners, to our jobs, and to our children, whenever we can just take the moments for self-care. Whatever that looks like for you.
That was scriptural.
And the visual that I always love, and I'll do it really quickly, that Lisa Nichols talks about, I know a lot of you know her, is the idea of picture this is a saucer and a teacup on my hand, okay? Pour a little tea in it. Now most women, they're like, I got a little liquid in me and I'm good to give. Stop, no, wait, pour more. Pour till the cup is full. Then you think, my cup is full, I can give now. Stop, no, give yourself a little more, because you shouldn't be serving the world from your cup. You should be serving it from your saucer.
Yeah.
Every moment that you feel like you're enough, so like, am I giving from my cup or am I giving from my saucer? And you can call me if you're not sure.
You know, I am called to missions. So a lot of my time is on the mission field away from my husband and two children. And for a moment, I felt the balance or neglecting what God had called me to do, the family. I remember really clearly, I heard, the first mission is your home. You don't have to compromise or compete if that is taken care of and is taken care of good and well. do that right first, so then the rest will flow, and that success. And so I did that right. Not only did I do it right, and I'm continuing to do it right, but I'm bringing them in. So when I brought them in to the gift and the vision that God has given me, now they're a part of it. Now they have ownership, and they do it with me. So there's no real compromise. There's no, you know, the success is still there, but now I'm doing it with family.
So often, especially with you guys, and now me when I'm traveling, you do feel guilty, and you talk about me, you often take advantage of times like this to make it, a family vacay. And so I bring my family. Not all the time can we afford that. You know, that's expensive. And so making that compromise and knowing that this is what you're called to do so that you can continue to do it but not neglect your family is very, very important. But if you can, when you travel and do those things, if you can, like Chris said, make it a part of your family, then it just builds a bigger bond and they buy into it. Mm-hmm. My son showed up at the last Motivated Moms tour. He jumped on stage like, hey, Motivated Moms. Like, you know, he told me last night that he was praying for y'all and he hope y'all have a good time. And I promise he did. So it's good when your family buys in. Talking about finances, how did having children affect you all's finances?
It has affected us in the sense where, you know, our kids used to be in private school. You know, it cost us a lot of money to keep them in private school. And, you know, when my career slowed down, Flex's career kind of slowed down for a minute. We couldn't afford it. And that was pretty difficult. And so kids are expensive. But it's worth it. And now, thanks to God, we're able to be on it. We work together. Our kids, we have a reality show. Now money's flowing again. The kids are part of it. And God always works it out.
He does. I would say we had to sacrifice a lot, my husband and I, so we couldn't have all the nice things we wanted to ensure that, you know, our kids were provided for. I don't think our kids, my daughter's here now, ever realized that we had to sacrifice. And my husband and I always talk about this a lot. You know, when we grew up, we didn't have a lot because we both came from single-parent homes. And we tried to give our kids everything. So we struggle with what financial lessons to give to our kids and doing that. So now my daughter should be 25 next month. We're trying to course correct, you know, to say, okay, you know, these things take sacrifice and you need to save and invest and plan in order to have the things that you want.
We try to overcompensate with our children where we lacked. Yeah. And that gets us in trouble. And it gets us in trouble financially, but it also sets our children up for failure sometimes. And that's why we have these children who want, they feel like they're entitled.
Yes.
Who told you about that?
I was pregnant at 18 years old, had my first child at 19, and so I was still really broke when I started having children. My career took off after all of that. My children were still really too young to know how poor they were when they were really young, but never was their poor my poor. I was homeless twice before I was 18, and my life was just a lot of different things. I slept outside, I grew up in New York, and that wasn't fun. So with all of those things, and it's interesting because growing up in the family that I grew up in and everybody being in ministry, and my grandfather's thing was missions, and so he was always giving. And so even when we didn't have, we were still trying to figure out how to give. And so my determination was that my children would never understand. So you're absolutely right. When we walk into our success, we go, my kids are never gonna, and I was adamant about that. My children will never know what I know. They will never know what it is to sleep outside. They will never know what it is to have holes in their shoes. They will never. But the great thing about it is because I did come from this amazing background of mission-minded individuals who worked in that field, my children did know what it was to give. I took them to where I grew up. They saw where we slept outside. I took them to the building and the projects where we lived when we lived there. And I made it a regular part of my children's lives when they were younger. They had to come with me to the nursing home. I did that with my grandfather. He would go and do two services a week at the nursing home. I would call us for the nursing home services. So I made them do it. I would go, I would take them, and then I started getting other parents to let their kids come with me and take the kids to the nursing homes, and we would do services for the elderly. And then I found creative ways also, we talked about this in the last city, to punish my children, because it's really, really hard to punish kids that don't know what it is not to have.
Right.
And so my kids thought they were getting away with it at a point in 1 year, and so they just weren't doing how I expected them to do. I told them, I expect you to bring me good grades. I expect you to keep up your part of the house, which is your home. I expect you to do what I say do. And it just wasn't working out like that. They started developing this kind of attitude, well, mom's on the road anyway, so if I'm gonna get it, I'm gonna have to wait till she come home. So I got them in there. So 1 year they were proud donators of an entire Christmas to a family that couldn't afford it.
That was not their choice.
Well, and we found a family with children who were their ages. I told this in another city. And we went and we did all the shopping. All the wrapping, and I told them, this is what happens. You don't respect what you had that you didn't have to work for. There's somebody's mommy and daddy out there who can't do what happens for you. Christmas is, but you get this stuff every day. So now you gonna play Jesus Claus. And we're gonna go find somebody. We're gonna go find somebody who doesn't have it as good as you do. And so I would teach them lessons like that. But my children have said, every year I would take my children to serve at Thanksgiving and at Christmas. And we do it, they're grown now, but we did it every year. And what I do love, and this is another thing to another point, what you'll find is that even when it seems like your kids are just losing their mind and they don't get it, they get it. My 22-year-old lives in North Carolina. She said, Mommy, I found a nursing home that I go to now, and I just go visit the people, and I just sing to them. Yes. She's 22.
Yes.
She's a single young woman living in a state that I don't live in, but she can't get away from it. So don't feel like what you teach them doesn't stick. Train a child up in the way she's going on his own. He will not depart from it. That's right. He's not going to depart at some point, but they will come back to it. So just there are ways to do it.